मॉर्निंग।
हेलो
हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एंड
गुड मॉर्निंग एंड
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
We will start with welcome to lecture number 10, and we will continue on our discussion with cash. As I mentioned in the last lecture, there is a memory inside the CPU. Wherein we fetch some required instructions and data and keep it inside this high-speed memory so that the CPU can use this for processing. The reason why we need an high-speed memory inside is that the memory, the traditional random access memory, is several orders of magnitude slower than the processor CPU. The traditional random access memory is several orders of magnitude slower than the CPU. And one of the ways by which, in general, when you want to interface a very high speed element with a low speed element, normally the interface will have a buffer. In this buffer, you basically read and write some data which will be consumed or by the other peripheral. So, to max speed, the buffer is a concept that is introduced between two devices so that we match speed. In this case, in a very broad way, we can think of the cache as a buffer between a very high speed CPU and the RAM. Now, today I will look at, we will look at what are all the different forms of cache, some cache policies. So we will handle some of this in detail in today's class. Cache can be classified into two based on certain policy. One policy is called the write back policy, another is called the write through policy. What is the write back policy? I access location say 1000 from the RAM. This location 1000 is transferred to the cache. So I want to read location 1000. So let me just assume that the number 5 is stored in the location 1000. This 5 is moved into the cache, saying that there is an address 1000 in which 5 is stored. When the CPU wants to access 1000 for the first time, it comes to the RAM, it takes the value and stores it in the cache. Subsequently, if it wants to access 1000, suppose it wants to read from 1000, it wants to write into 1000, all those things when the CPU wants to do, it does only in the cache. It doesn't come to the memory. By this, what you gain is that all my access to the location 1000, again I repeat, the word access I use for and write into the memory. When I want to read and write into 1000, subsequently, the first time I want to read or write from 1000, I take it from the RAM, I store 1005. Essentially, I tell the cache that in location 1000 there is 5. The CPU basically reads from this 5. Then subsequently, if you want to read or write from 1000, it need not come to the RAM, but it can access from the cache. So I want to write, say, 7 into this location. So it will write 7 in the cache. If I want to write 8 into the location, to write 8 into the cache. If you want to read from that location, to read directly from the cache. So any access to 1000 will never come to the RAM, but it will just stay off in the cache. By this, the speed of memory access actually increases several fold. For me to access cache will take several orders of magnitude faster, will be faster than accessing the memory. Now, when we look at these two type of caches, one is the write back and another is the write through policy, this is how the scenarios are. Let me assume that initially in the location 1000, the value 5 is stored. The first time the CPU accesses 1000, it will not find it in the cache. So it will go to the memory and read this location 1000 with the value 5. Now, when it wants to write 6 into this, in the write back policy, it will write 6 here. But it will not write 6 into the RAM. Again, it is going to write some 7 into 1000. It will write 7 here only and not into the RAM. So this is the write back policy where I write only into the cache, but I will not update the RAM. So what happens here is the value, the latest value of location 1000, the latest value stored in address 1000 is available in the cache and not in the RAM. So there is a discrepancy or there is a difference between the value that is stored in the cache versus the value that is stored in the RAM. This discrepancy or difference is called the cache coherency problem. The cache coherency problem is that the value that I store in the cache for against a particular location, namely 1000 here, the value I have stored is 7, but corresponding location in the memory, the address 1000 location, has a value that is different from what I have stored in the cache. And this cache coherency problem basically comes when I have this write back policy, wherein when I want to write into 1000, I write only into the cache copy of the 1000 and I don't go and update the RAM. To avoid this cache coherency problem, what the processor does is, when it wants to write into 1000, it writes to the 1000 here, and it also goes and writes into the RAM. When it wants to read from 1000, it can just read from here. It need not come to the RAM and read, because what is there in the cache and whatever is there in the RAM are the same. But only when I am writing into the location 1000, then I go and write into a location, and immediately I also copy the same value into the RAM. This is basically called as write-through policy. In the case of write-through policy, the cache coherency problem does not exist. While in the case of the write-back policy, the cache coherency problem exists. So the cache, one of the first classification of cache can be in the form of two: the write back cache, the write through cache. The write back cache is one wherein when I update, when I write into a location in the cache, I do not go and change the same in the memory. But in the case of a write back cache, in the case of a write through cache, When I write into the location, I go and change it immediately. The memory. And the advantage of write through is that it avoids the cache coherency problem, while in the write back the cache coherency problem exists. While in the case of the advantage in case of write back is your writes are faster. In the case of write through policy is your writes can become slower, because every write that I do not only in the cache, but I go and do in the RAM. So as far as write is concerned, I'm still working with a very fast CPU, I'm still working with a very slow random access memory. So this is one fundamental classification of cache based on the writing decisions. Okay. Now let us go and look at the organization of the cache. So let me say that the random access memory has say 32 locations, 0, 1, 2, 3 till 31. You need 5 bits to address this memory, because for 31 I need 5 bits to represent 31. So the addresses would be 00000, 00001 till 11111. Let me assume for the sake of this explanation that the RAM has only 32 addressable locations, and those have the address 0 to 31, and you need 5 bits to represent. Let us now the cache. Essentially, the cache cannot be as large as the RAM, right? If I am going to put the entire random access memory inside the chip, then the chip will become very large. It will consume lot of power. You can't make such a chip. So the cache will be very small. Say, let the cache be just having 8 locations. So this is the CPU. And this is the RAM, and this is the bus connecting them. Now the cache here has 8 locations. But 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And I need 3 bits to represent. Okay, now the CPU, so without loss of generality, let us just say some values are stored here. Say 5, 7, 11, 12, 1. Now, obviously I cannot store all the 32 values in the cache. I can store only 8 of them. So how will I store that 8? So what really happens here? Now let us say that I go and access location number 1. So what is the value stored in location number 1? Its value is 7. First the CPU will start accessing location number 1 in the random access memory. And it will find that 1 is not stored anywhere. Nothing is stored in the cache to start with. When the processor tries to access an address A and that address is not stored in the cache, then what happens is we call that there is a cache miss. The address I want is not available in the cache. So apparently I land up with a cache miss. The moment there is a cache miss, the CPU goes to the memory and it fetches the value. And where will it store the value? So, I can now do a very simple calculation. I have only 8 bytes, but I have only 8 locations in the cache, but I have 32 locations in the RAM. That means at least 4 memory locations, 4 addresses should share one location. So I just decide based on the last 3 bits. I use the last 3 bits to find out where the memory should be stored. So when I access the location 1, okay, I am finding 7. Where will I store that 7 in the cache? I make a judgment by looking at the last 3 bits. The last 3 bits of location 1 is 001. So I go to 001 and store the value 7. Now I am accessing say location number 8. Random access memory 8. What is that address? 01 is the address. Let me assume that some 25 is stored in that location 8. So where will I go and store this 8? I will again take the last 3 bits as I have told you and I will go and store the 25 here. So what I am doing is, given the address on the RAM, I take some of those bits which I make a decision of where I am going to store that element. This type of a cache is called, another classification of cache, this is called a direct map cache. What is direct about this? What is mapping here? I am mapping addresses on the RAM onto the cache. I am mapping addresses on the RAM into locations in the cache. I map location number 1 to 1, location number 8 to 0. Since I am mapping addresses on the RAM onto locations in the cache, that is why I get the word map. And what is direct about it? I don't do any computation. I just take this address in the RAM, take some bits of that address and use it to map it onto the cache. I take some bits on that address and use it to map it onto the cache. Now, that makes the job very easier for the CPU, because when it fetches a value from the memory, it need not wait or it need not do any extra computation, but just extract the bits and use those bits to store in the cache. And that is why we call it as a direct mapped cache. It's called a mapped cache because I'm mapping addresses on the memory RAM to addresses on the cache. And that mapping does not involve any computation, but it just means to take directly some bits in the address and use it to get stored. So this type of a cache organization is called direct map cache organization. Okay, so what did we do? We stored address 1 in 7, address 8 in 25. Now let us say what will happen when address 9 need to come here. Address 9 is 01001 and that stores the value 30. Let us assume that address 9 here, 8 was storing some 25 and 9 stores some 30. Let us say that address 9 now needs to be fetched. Now if you take the last 3 bits of this address, again 001. So essentially this 7 has to now get replaced by 30. That means I am replacing address 00001 by 01001. Note that both mapped onto the same location into cache. Though they mapped onto the same location in the cache, since they mapped onto the same the cache, I have to replace address 1 by address 9. Now, how will the processor basically access? Suppose it wants to access 9 again. As I told you earlier, it need not come all the way to the memory. It can access from here itself. How will the processor access 9? It will take the last 3 bits. If at all 9 is going to be stored in the memory, then it will be stored in the location 001. It cannot be stored in any other location. So it will go to 001 and find if 9 is stored there. Is 9 stored there? Yes, here it gets 30. But it uses the last 3 bits to come to this point and it finds that there is a value 30. But now please understand, whether it belongs to the address 9 or it belongs to the address 1. Because both maps on to 30, both maps on to the location 1. So this 30, does it belong to location 9 or location 1, or we can do anything that ends with 001 here. So I can put even 11001. So what is this? 25. Does it belong to address 25 or does it belong to address 1 or does it belong to address 9? The processor cannot find out. So what should the processor store here is along with the value, it needs to store a tag. This tag will tell me whether the 30 that is stored here, does it belong to address 9 or does it belong to address 1 or does it belong to address 25 and so on. So what would be the tag? Please note that if I store the first two most significant bit as a tag, then I can do this distinction. So what I store in say this location 1 would be now 01, which is the tag, and then I store 30. If I store 01 and 30 and the processor wants to go and access say location 9, the processor will generate the address 01001. Now it will take the last 3 bits. It will come and find out there is a value 30. Then it will take the first 2 bits and compare with the tag and it finds, oh, they are equal. So from that it will conclude that the location 9 essentially is stored in the cache and the value is 30. Suppose the processor wants to access say location 25, it again takes the last 3 bits, namely 001. It comes to the cache, it finds the value 30, then it takes the first two bits, that is 1, 1, 1, but what is stored here is 1. So there is a mismatch in the tag. So the processor will understand that what is stored there in that particular location does not belong to 25, but it belongs to something else. Right? So a cache entry in a cache comprises 2 things, one thing is a value of some location that is mapped onto it from the memory. In this case, if I store 30 with 01, this is the value of the location 9 that is mapped onto this, along with tag, which is used to tell the CPU out of several locations that could map onto the same location in the cache. As I told you, there are 32 locations in the memory and only 8 locations in the cache. So each location, at least 4 addresses will map onto the same location in the cache. So out of several locations that could map onto the same location in the cache, this tag will help us to find out which one of them is actually stored here. So in this case, so let us redraw this diagram, and then I will basically tell you a set of cache operations by which you will understand how the entire cache works. So there is a question from BTKIT. I think I have answered that question. So we will now do one more exercise to explain the working of the cache, so that all the concepts that we have described so far will become quite clear. So this is a CPU. It has 8 locations for cache. There is a tag and there is a value, the cache. So I can say the 8 locations are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And I have a RAM. It stores the value, and the addresses are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, 11, 12. I'm continuing the RAM here. Without loss of generality, let us now put some numbers here: 25, 46, 39, 48, 76, 61, 1, 97, 113, 45, 59, 118, 251, 52. So let me say these are all the values that are initially stored in the RAM. Now, let us see set of operations that we want to perform. Operation number one, say, let me say I want to read location 4. What is 4 here? It is 00100. The location 4 will now map on to the location 100 in the cache. 100 is 4 here in the cache. So what will I store here? I will store 76. First the CPU will start reading into 4. In 4 it doesn't find any value. Essentially this is a cache miss. So it will go to the memory, fetch that value 76 and store here. Now note that on to 4, what are all the other addresses that will map on to 4? All these addresses will map onto the location 4 in the cache. The address 4 of the memory will map. The address 12 of the memory will map. Address 20 of the memory will map. Address 28 of the memory will map. Now out of these 4 locations that will map onto the same location in the cache, I want to distinguish and say S4 has come. So the tag I will store here is 00. The moment I store the tag here as 00, then the processor will know that yes, something is stored in location 4, but and that address out of the 4 addresses that can map on to 4, the address 4, that is namely 4, 12, 20 and 28, the address 4 has mapped them. Let me say I am going to read from 6. What I read from 6? What happens when I read from 6? What is 6? 00110. I do read 6. So 110 is maps on to the location 6 here. So this is 00 and the location from 6 is. Now let me say I read from 11. What is 11 here? 01011. This is 11. So the last 3 bits are 011, so it is going to get stored in location number 3 and the tag value is the first 2 bits, so 01 and 11 is 180. So in all the 3 reads that happened, there was a cache miss, right? Because the cache did not store the value, we fetched it from the memory and put it into the cache. So always when I read a location for the first time, it will not be in the cache and I have to fetch it from the cache. So whenever I read a value, an address for the first time, always I will have a miss and that miss is called compulsory miss. Compulsory miss. Why it is compulsory? The first time I am fetching, it will not be in the cache. I have to go and fetch it from the memory. And that is compulsory or mandatory for me to fetch from memory. Okay. So this is done now. Right. Now I go and write into 11. Let me assume that this is a write back policy. So I write into, I write what value into 11? Say I write, say I make 11 as say 143. So what is 11? 01011. So So I go to this place, I find S11 is already stored, so this is a cache hit. Cache hit, yes, I find 11 to be stored here, so I want to go and change the value. So what I go and, I go and change this value to 143. So because I am writing into 11 the value 143. Now note that the value stored in the cache is 143 while the value stored in the RAM is 89 and there is a cache coherency problem. Now what happens? Next time, let me say I am going to access 19, I am reading 19. So let us read 19. So what is 19? 10001. This is 19. So 19 actually maps onto location 3. So what should happen to the cache? Now I will fetch this 19 location, that is 1027. So this data should become 1027 and this tag should be 10. Can I just come and overwrite this 1027 here with 10? I cannot do it because before doing it, I have to update this location. This is, there is a difference, right? There is 118 here and there is 143 here. Currently 11 has 143. So I have to update the memory. So this 143 is first updated 143 and then what we do is we bring 19 and makes this 1027 and then make this one. So please understand, when I bring a location I am assuming write back policy, wherein when I write into a location I only write into the cache, I do not go and write back into the memory, write into the memory. When I bring a location, when I read a location and write into that location and I create a cache coherency problem, that is what is stored in the cache and what is stored in the memory are different, and then I want to overwrite that location. So what I read 11, I wrote into 11, 143, which was different from what is stored in the memory. Now I want to erase that 11 and load 19. Before I erase 11 and load the value of 19, I have to go and update back into the memory. So that is something that we need to do. But now let us go and say I am reading 12. So what is 12? 01100. So where will 12 map on to? It will map on to the location 4. It will map on to the location. So that has mapped on to the location 4. So already in 4, the location 4 is there. So I want to read 12. So in this case, I can just take 251 and write it here. So what I have to do, I have to make this as 01 and now this will become 251. That's what I need to do. Should I now copy 76 back and then get 251? I need not do, because after I read the location 4, I did not go and change it at all. I kept it in the same value. Now if I want to erase that location 4 and load say location 12, I can just go without any replacement, without any writing back, I can now go and make this 0, 1. And I can make this as 251. So in this entire sequence, we have seen 5 reads and 1 write. In one of those reads, we need to go and replace the value. In another read, in 2 reads, I have overwritten the locations. In one occasion, I went and wrote back the value. In another occasion, I didn't write back the value. Why I wrote back the value in the first occasion is that because the value that was stored in the cache, the value that was stored in the RAM. Why I did not write back in the second occasion was that the value that was stored in the cache was same as the value that was stored in the RAM in the case of 4. Now, if I decide every time I erase, I will go and write back into the memory and then erase, that means I am going to increase the number of memory operations. By increasing the number of memory operations, what happens? The whole operation becomes slower. The performance degrades. Because memory is slower, then the processor much slower than the processor. And if I start accessing memory more frequently, then my performance of the entire program decreases. So I would like to go and access the memory as less as possible. So if I go and decide here, every time I am replacing something in the cache, I want to go and write back the current value into the cache and get the new value, then I am not doing the correct thing. My performance would be bad. Whenever there is a necessity for me to go and write back the value in the RAM, and that is where I should go and write back. Correct? So that when is the necessity for me to go and write back into the RAM? Whenever after I read a location into the cache, I go and change the value of the cache, then only I need to go and write back into the RAM. If I do not change the location in the, do not change the content of the particular address, then I need not go and write back into the RAM. Whenever there is a cache coherency problem, or whenever, in other words, whenever there is a difference between what is stored in the cache for that address versus what is stored in the RAM in that address, whenever there is a difference, then only I need to go and write. Now, when will there be a difference? After I fetch a particular location into the cache, when I go as a processor, when I go and write into that cache, then there is going to be a problem. So, to get this performance benefit, the processor now introduces another bit here. The processor introduces another bit here called the dirty bit. I will call it as the D bit. The dirty bit will become 1. The dirty bit will become 1 only when I go and change the value. So let us go back and do the whole exercise very so this is to start with. So I am reading 4. Essentially, I will get 00 as the tag and 76 here. Then I am reading 6. 6 is 00. 00110. So I will be getting a 1 here. Then I am reading 11. Reading 4, I will get 76 here. and note that the dirty bit is zero. That is, after I read, nothing I have changed. What if the dirty bit is zero, whatever is stored for address 4 in the cache is the same as what is stored in the address in the RAM. Similarly for the location 6. Then I am reading 11. 11 actually maps on to 1011. So 11 will become 01 here, and the location here would be the value here would be 180. Now I am writing into 11 the value 143. The moment I write the value 143, the dirty bit here becomes 1. So now I am reading so now I want to read actually not 19, something that will map on to this. Yeah. 19, sorry. I want to read 19, which is 10011. It will map to this. Before I read the value of 19 here, I find that the dirty bit is 1, and so immediately I will copy back 143 here, and now I will read 19, this will become 10 and this will become 1027. Again the dirty bit will become 0. Now I am reading 12. Now since the dirty bit is 0, I need not copy this value 76 back to 4. So I just replace this with 01 and the value in 12, which is 250. So this is the advantage of having the dirty bit. By having the dirty bit, we basically see to it that my performance of my number of accesses to the memory decreases because I avoid one replacement whenever I am replacing a location in the cache. Right. Now another thing, suppose I say read 15 here. What is 15? 01111. So that means location 7. See, in any system, when I switch on a system, these are all memory locations. There will be some random values in these registers. So how will I know that the value stored in this, there will be some junk value. So let me say without loss of generality, let me say 00, some 250, one, some 0. Some junk value will be there in this. How do you know that whether it is a junk value or it is a value that is loaded by the processor? I need to make that distinction. Whenever I am maintaining a table wherein I am storing data, I need to make a very clear distinction between whether I am going to have the value that is stored in the table is junk or is there some, the processor has actually updated it. To get to this, there is one more bit that this process, this cache has, it is called the valid bit. So the valid, and whenever the processor is updating this, it will make the valid bit as 1. So in this case, when it reaches 15, it will make the valid bit as 1, and then it will store 01, and whatever the value in 15 may be 80. So when the valid bit of a location is 0, then I know that junk is stored in that location, so automatically it is a cache miss. If the valid bit is 1 and my tag does not match, For example, now I am reading 4, which is 00100. I come to that 100 location and I find, yes, the valid bit is 1. So some relevant data is stored. Now I take the tag which is 00 for location 4 and match it with the tag here which is 01, and then there is a tag mismatch. Then there is a catch. So this explains you the notion of a direct cache, direct mapped cache. In the direct mapped cache, I have basically explained you why we need the dirty bit. It can also be called the clean bit. Some of people who write books are fond of, you know, negative things. So they say call it dirty bit. Okay. Fortunately, they call it a valid bit rather than saying invalid bit. Okay. So there is a valid bit, there is a dirty bit, there is a tag, and there is a space for storing the actual value. This comprises a cache, and today we have explained you what we mean by organizing a direct mapped cache by taking a toy example. In practice, this cache could run to MBs, megabytes, the memory could run to gigabytes, and the cache could run to megabytes. That is what you see in current day process. But we have just managed to explain you the concept using some 32 locations and 8 locations. With this, I wind up. We have time for 1 or 2 questions. Yes? RVC. Please ask your question. RVCE, please ask your question. Yes.
Bolo. Bolo, bolo.
PTKIT, please ask your question.
Hello.
Yes. Yes, hello. Please ask your question.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello.
I can hear you. Please ask your question.
Hello. Is it audible, sir?
Yes, you are very, very hello? Clearly audible.
Is it audible?
You are audible. Audible, audible. Volume, volume increase. I can't hear that lady talk. Can you please?
Jor se bolo. Bolo.
Can that student come to the front and talk in the mic?
बोलो ना तुम बोलती रहो जोर से बोलो अरे बोल बोलो कौन सा प्रायोरिटी बिट की बात कर रहे हो टैग
ECRU, can you ask your question? Yeah. I put chat here. We'll just answer the question one or two. Please explain the dirty bit. Okay. The dirty bit is one which indicates whether there is a difference between the value that is stored in the cache versus the value that is stored in the RAM. For example, let me take 5. I read from 5. So I go to the location 5 in the cache. I store 00 and the value 81. My dirty bit is 0 to start with because the value I have stored in the cache and the value that I see in the RAM are the same. Now I go and write into that 5. That means, say I am writing some 172 into this location. Now the value I am storing in the cache versus the value I am storing in the RAM, they are different. The moment I go and change the value that is stored in the cache, immediately I will make the dirty bit 1. Okay. Now why I need this dirty bit is, let us look at, I want to write into location 21 in the memory, read from 21. So what is 21? 10101. So when I want to read from 21, say 106, first what I have to do is, since the dirty bit is 1, that indicates what I have stored for location 5 in the cache is different from what I have stored for location 5 in the RAM. Immediately I have to go and replace 81 by 172, and then now I will fetch 21. 21 means the tag will become 10 and the value that I fetch would be 106. And now again the dirty bit becomes 0 because for the location 21, the value I have stored in the cache versus the value I have stored in the memory is the same. So this is where I use the dirty bit, and this is the necessity for the dirty bit. Next. Suppose there are two data stored at location, then now the data shall be stored in cache. What happens if all the locations in the cache is full and I want further process to be done? Every time I want to read or write, there is a replacement that is happening. For example, all the locations in the cache also need not be full. For example, I read from 5 and then I am reading from 21, there is a clash between 5 and 21. I progress to 21 replacing 5. So nowhere, because of cache being full, this thing will stop. The processing will stop. I first read from 5 and I was processing with 5. Now 21 comes in, I have to replace 5 by 21. If something else comes in, I will replace it and keep going. So nowhere the process will stop, the program will stop because the cache is full. There is no notion of cache being full. There is a notion of conflict, two addresses mapping onto the same location, and they when they map, the conflict is immediately resolved by replacing the old one by the new one. Right. Please explain role of dirty bit in cache hits and cache misses. I think I have explained it several times. Now please go and look into the video very carefully. Please don't sleep in the class. Please look into the video carefully. I think you will understand it. Okay. So I am winding up. We'll see on Friday 8 a.m. Please revise the class and come. Please. So whatever I have taught in the previous classes, please do revise. Please look into the lecture. We have recorded that lecture and it has been made available to you. Please look back into that lecture and come. This is a course, it can't be done in isolation. Every class is very, very tightly coupled to the previous class. So if you don't know the previous class or you don't remember what happened in the previous class, every class would be a torture to you and to me also. So please do revise all these lectures and come, look at the videos and come. Thank you.